that is really the pinnacle. That there's another civilization in existence that's intelligent, that we know about. And we actually have artifacts from them that can operate.
This video is a collaborative project with The Orchard, a media company that recently distributed Jeremy Corbell's new film, Bob Lazar, Area 51 and Flying Saucers. I've been allowed to use their footage, and there are no restrictions on what I can say. This was crucial, as my thoughts on Lazar sometimes differ than those presented in Corbell's documentary. By the end of this video, I hope to have carefully represented those who are convinced Lazar is telling the truth, and also those who believe he's constructed one of the most popular fabrications of the 21st century.
And quite frankly, I could make up a better lie, but I have no motivation to lie. There are some things I can say that will bolster the case, and I'm not going to. It's gonna stay that way.
When you hear an argument against Lazar, a bar will show up at the bottom of the screen, the color red. When you hear an argument for Lazar, the same bar will show up, but in the color blue. My opinion is not represented by either the red or blue bar, as I won't be giving my actual opinion until the final scene. Try and think of yourself as part of a jury, and it's my job to represent both the defense and the prosecutor. Let's start at the beginning.
However, the science and the technology can change us dramatically. It can change the way the entire world operates, the economy, everything.
Robert Scott Lazar, or Bob Lazar, claims he worked on the back engineering of alien spacecraft at a base near Area 51 called S4. Bob says he attained a master's degree in physics from MIT, and also a master's degree in technology from Caltech. But there's zero evidence for this.
I checked at MIT, I checked at Caltech, neither one ever heard of them.
If Lazar is telling the truth, how come there's no evidence of his stated educational background? This discrepancy alone is sufficient proof that he's lying. Why should I believe anything else he says, when MIT and Caltech continually refute Bob had anything to do with them? There are many possible reasons for this. In his attempt to locate Bob's alleged master thesis, John Andrews, a principal designer for the Testers Company, sent out multiple inquiries to different institutions. After some time passed, a response finally came from John Orth, Special Projects, who said, "I cannot imagine that MIT cannot find it," which suggests that perhaps the thesis was done on a security classified project, and the thesis itself is classified. Is it possible that Lazar's thesis was made classified? But even if that were true, which I don't think it is, it still wouldn't explain why he wasn't in their yearbook. Now you have to assume the government invited themselves into every household of the same class and magically made Lazar's pictures disappear. But you're assuming he took a yearbook picture at all. Physicist Dr. Robert Krangle, the man responsible for inventing the laser rangefinder that is now used in police traffic radar units, says he attended security meetings with Lazar at Los Alamos and had this to say about the yearbook debacle.
You know, that's for undergrads. You know, the class of, you know, the class of 70, the class of 71. That's an undergrad getting your bachelor. When you're up there getting a graduate degree, you're not like with a class.
So like a master's or something?
Right.
Really?
Right. You're okay. You're in there as an independent. There's not like a class of 70 for your master's.
But this is just one random person saying things. Plenty of people who are getting their masters can be found inside of a yearbook, and you still haven't brought up Caltech. They also have no records of his involvement. How do you move around that? During George Knapp's investigation into Lazar's background, he discovered that multiple people who knew Lazar stated that Bob did, in fact, attend Caltech.
Jim Taliani, for one, who said that, yeah, Bob went to Caltech back then. I dropped him off. I interviewed another person who also knew Bob then and said that he would drop him off at Caltech, pick him up from the library, that if he wasn't going to school there, he sure was making a good show of it back then.
The credibility of George Knapp is zero. He's a conspiracy theorist who has a vested interest in maintaining Lazar's credibility because he is the one who broke the story. How embarrassing would it be for him if his biggest story was a flop? Notice how Knapp responds when he reflects on the past, when he found out Bob was being convicted of pandering for a brothel.
And when he told me about it, I thought, oh my gosh, my professional life is flashing before my eyes here, the most high-profile witness and the biggest story I've ever done.
This is not the sound of a man pursuing truth, but of a man only interested in maintaining his reputation as a journalist. But a person can be interested in what's true and also their reputation. But the credibility of Knapp, which I would argue is very good, is not the point. If Lazar is lying, why did Los Alamos Laboratory deny he ever worked there, even after being presented proof that he worked there?
They were either mistaken or were lying. A 1982 phone book from the lab lists Lazar right there among the other scientists and technicians.
Los Alamos denies I've ever worked there, as does Kirkmeyer, even the subcontractor for Los Alamos, which is interesting. We went back and were able to dig up an inner lab directory phone book with my name in it. Certainly I got some of my colleagues from Los Alamos to verify that I worked there, but for the most part, Los Alamos has kept everything pretty quiet and even denies that I ever lived in the town, though I'm known by many people in the town and many of the people I worked with, supervisors, so on and so forth.
How do you explain the Los Alamos Monitor, a newspaper, profiling Lazar's interest in jet cars, referring to him as a physicist from Los Alamos? Could the newspaper be mistaken? It's possible. But again, even physicist Dr. Robert Krangel recently came forward stating he worked with Lazar at Los Alamos.
You did know that he was a physicist?
Yes.
And that was very clear to you, that he was a physicist at Los Alamos and not, again, like the janitor.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
During Robert's trial for creating a computer program for the brothel, the judge encountered the same difficulties, unable to attain any significant information on Lazar at all.
It's obvious that it's very difficult to get information on Mr. Lazar from government sources, enormously difficult.
All of this suggests that aspects of Lazar's history have been tampered with or erased. And if you can do it at Los Alamos, you can do it somewhere else.
Doesn't have the credentials. That was another issue. It was his educational background.
He finished in the bottom third of his high school class. You can't get into MIT if you're outside. Usually the top 10, 15, 20% of your class. Bottom third, never.
But Lazar's name on the laboratory directory doesn't mean anything substantial. He could have worked there part-time as a subcontractor. It could also be a completely different Robert Lazar. And as you said, it's possible the newspaper could have made a mistake. But what's even more likely is that Lazar lied to them too. And even if he did work at Los Alamos, which he probably didn't, his name on a directory doesn't prove his supposed Q clearance, or what he later calls majestic clearance, something that doesn't exist. It's also obvious that the judge can't find any government-sourced information on Lazar because he's never actually worked for the government. Same with their inability to find his records at MIT and Caltech. But if he didn't go to MIT or Caltech, how was he able to work at Los Alamos, one of the most expensive comprehensive laboratories in the United States? Will they allow someone to work on the equipment who had no professional expertise?
Do you think Los Alamos just hired me out of high school? If you don't think that's possible, then something had to happen in between. I don't understand how everybody gets so caught up in the minutiae, because you can debate that stuff forever. We can go back before MIT and you can start fighting whether or not and where I lived in high school. That is not going to translate into answering the questions and the things that I've brought into the public eye. That's the important stuff. It almost seems like this is an intentional distraction.
If Lazar is lying, how is he able to know that on Wednesday night at Papoose Lake, test flights were being conducted of the alleged craft.
Look how bright it's getting!
Look at it now.
The time when Bob said there would be a test, there was a strange light jumping around in the sky above the location where he said it would be at the time and date he said it would be.
If this video isn't fake, it's likely footage of Janet Airlines flights, which John Lear, Bob's good friend at the time, would know about given his obsessions with observing the base. No planes could fly over Papoose Lake as it was restricted airspace. Secondly, when the video is enhanced, it holds a shape that looks nothing like the dimensions of a jet. Is it just a coincidence? The object appears to hold the same shape Lazar purported to be working on.
This is the first time there's a craft it's a reactionless craft. It's a field propulsion craft. And what it does is it creates a distortion in space and time in front of it, where space actually bends. And my analogy to that has always been, put a bowling ball in the middle of your bed, and then a foot in front of it, take your fist and push down on the mattress. The bowling ball will roll towards it. And that's exactly how the craft works. It creates a distortion right in front of it, and the craft falls forward.
The object is so far away. How can we be sure that a jet would look like a jet if the recording is of an object miles away?
Here, hold on, right here.
Combined with Lazar's lack of verifiable credentials, his claims about Element 115 are arguably the bombshells which prove he's lying. Contrary to what many claim, Element 115 was not, quote, discovered by Bob Lazar. Articles of the element were floating around Scientific American months before Bob made his claims, and beyond that, the element has none of the functional characteristics Bob claimed. But that doesn't mean we dismiss any chance of Element 115 being stabilized in the future. Methods exist that could eventually lead to a stabilized version of Element 115.
So I called some of the top heavy element physicists on the planet, three in particular who had really talked to me in depth about it. All of them, across the board, said you cannot rule out a stabilized version of Element 115.
If Bob is telling the truth, why hasn't he gotten cancer or become sick from working at S4, an area whose east end was the location of multiple atomic tests? The government would never have scientists work for them in an environment that could get them sick. Yes, they would. In an article from the Washington Post, Area 51, Secrets Under the Sun, the author revealed the death of Wally Casa, a sheet metal worker who worked for decades in different departments surrounding the Nevada test site, including Area 51. His death was purported to be the result of radiation. These men worked in far worse conditions than anything Lazar claims to have participated in. Workers said they labored in thick, choking clouds of poisonous smoke as hazardous wastes were burned in huge open trenches on the site.
What is it that you think is most misunderstood?
That he really is an honest guy. You know, he doesn't make stuff up.
If Bob is lying, how is he able to pass every polygraph test he's ever taken? Well, there's a reason polygraph tests aren't allowed in court of law. According to the American Psychological Association, the idea that we can detect a person's veracity by monitoring psychophysiological changes is more myth than reality. This is because an honest person could feel anxious and score a lie, while an intentional deceiver could exude no physical characteristics of anxiousness at all.
I don't know, I guess the point is, do I really care what people I don't know think? And probably to some extent I do, but I don't dwell on it.
Most who believe Lazar often point to his supposed W-2 as proof he worked for the Department of Naval Intelligence, a department that doesn't exist, by the way, it's the Office of Naval Intelligence, but a simple search of the stated employee identification number pulls up nothing. Yet another example of how Lazar's story falls apart under the least bit of investigation. But that fails to consider something important. If an agency is operating outside the purview of the government, it must ensure the distortion of any documentation that is given to the public, at least where it matters. To give you one point of contact, consider the majestic clearance documents in the FBI files, all written over with the word bogus. The reason the FBI gives for dismissing the veracity of these documents, which was an alleged group dedicated to researching UFOs, was the inconsistencies found in the language that was used. But what better way is there to ensure the secrecy of a project than by creating documents that officials who were outside the need to know would view as a hoax?
There's nothing to hide. There's nothing to hide at all.
The big thing is the suppression of extremely advanced technology and the suppression of unknown science.
Consider for a moment that this man, Jerry Freeman, traveled to the exact area where Lazar's alleged S4 base was supposed to be located. And as is demonstrated by this picture, nothing is there. He then died 2 years later, allegedly from radiation poisoning, another telling sign that anyone near S4 is right on top of fatal radiation levels. If Lazar is telling the truth, how come when the Greenpeace organization successfully held a demonstration at Papoose Lake, they reported there was no top secret installation of any kind? Both Jerry Freeman and the Greenpeace demonstration traveled near S4 years after Lazar went public. Given the volume of citizens flocking to S4's borders mere days after Lazar came forward, it makes perfect sense why the installation would be removed. But even if it wasn't removed, the base was built into natural infrastructure for the precise reason that the perimeter wouldn't be seen. It's also pure conjecture that Jerry died from radiation poisoning. But if it was from high rates of radiation, which it probably wasn't, one has to also mention that he hiked the entire Nevada test site for days. But ultimately, if the area was so toxic, wouldn't everyone present for the Greenpeace demonstration have died too? Yet they didn't. This rules out the radiation argument. It certainly rules out any comparison between the actions Jerry Freeman took and the brief time Lazar was at S4. Every time I feel I have a firm grasp on this story, I'm given reason to doubt it. The truth is, the endless arguing you heard is what appears in my mind while dissecting Bob Lazar. I'll become convinced that he's lying and live through that reality, astonished at how one man could lie with such an apparent lack of empathy or concern for the world. Then it'll switch, realizing how prevalent sightings of flying saucers were through the 50s and the 80s, and knowing that the idea of flying saucers wasn't a media or Hollywood invention first, as those creative endeavors occurred as a result of the waves of sightings that happened before it. Of course, most reports were benign, but others were not. Although many hyperbolized the government's ability to erase a person's background, it's not inconceivable, but it is improbable. And it's one reason why I sometimes lean more to the side of not believing parts of a story. But then I reflect on the test flights, and not just that Bob knew the time and place, which could be explained away by linking that information to John Lear, and not just that when the object is enhanced, it looks like the object Lazar claims to have worked on, although that is pretty substantial. It's the fact that the object isn't blinking on and off. I've yet to hear anyone bring this up. Videos of planes or jets flying at night, and you can film them and see for yourself, they just kind of look like a blinking light in a black sky. And although you might see a set of three or four lights remain constant, you'll still see a set of additional blinking lights going on and off every second or two. But this object has no blinking lights. I stabilized the footage and slowed it down by 50%, and as you can see, where are the blinking navigation lights, or the red and green navigation lights? It just looks like a solid light, whatever it is. And if you think this object is too far away to analyze, then I think it's safe to say that you and I have hit a stalemate. So while I currently struggle to completely grant certain aspects of Bob's story, there are also far too many factors that make his case impossible to dismiss. I've heard all the arguments and steelmanned them in my head constantly in an attempt to know what's true, but it's difficult. Much like a maze.
First time Barry showed me the reactor in operation, you know, here it is on the bench, and he said, you know, try and touch the sphere on top. And you couldn't, your hand was pushed away. Just like, you know, two light poles of a magnet. It's the exact same feeling, but it was no metal involved. And that's shocking. That's really shocking because nothing does that. That's an operating, powerful force field. So just seeing something like that immediately starts that whole chain reaction in your mind going, wow, wait, if you can do this, there can be force fields on tanks. There can be things that lift off the ground. We don't need jet and rocket engines anymore. That means there's no use for cars. I mean, boom, the whole thing changes. The entire world, the economy, everything would go end on end just if we had an answer to how that machine worked that I was sitting there touching.